Even the cities of Homs and Hama, again, these were part of the rural part of Syria. They became the heart of the Syrian uprising, because majority of the people also living in these areas were much worse affected by the new economic policies introduced by Bashar Assad. And again, as I mentioned earlier, in Syria too, the reliance of the security apparatus increased substantially. As people's unhappiness increased, the police and the remaining of the security apparatus was used much more openly and much more often in dealing with the popular unrest. Again, if you look at the international agencies' websites about Syria, they all commended the Syrian regime until a few months before the uprising started against Bashar Assad. They all said that Syria was doing extremely well because they changed the whole economic structure radically. I mean, for instance, in June 2005, during the 10th Regional Congress of the Ba'ath Party, the term social market economy was introduced as the key term to explain the whole Syrian the economic structure. And this was presented as a new economic model. But if you look at the various elements of it was a very typical neoliberal economic system, which was some maybe more than 10 years ago applied in Chile and in some other Latin American countries and in many other places in the world. So in a way, what happened in Syria and to some extent in many other places was the rise of new authoritarian neoliberalism. So a completely uncontrolled neoliberal economic policy accompanied by much more authoritarian regime to control the rising unhappiness and rising protests among the population. So in a way, this is to me the key aspect in order to understand the political economy background of the Arab Spring, this authoritarian neoliberal restructuring. In Syria, for instance, according to some United Nations figures, just before the uprising started, 5% of the population owns more than 50% of the wealth. And this was the result of 10-year application of authoritarian neoliberal restructuring. And again, all this left more than 30% people unemployed, and about 25% of them living under poverty in Syria. And again, one journalist mentioned just after the uprising started in Syria, one symbolic incident. When Bashar seized the power after his father, the young president ordered the removal of a massive picture of his father from one of the main squares in Damascus. And they replaced that picture with a Lipton tea advertisement of the same size. So in a way, that journalist mentioned that this symbolized very clearly what was going to come afterwards in whole Syria. So neoliberal measures, open neoliberal measures, replace the rule of Hafez Assad. And in 2009, the annual report from International Monetary Fund gave Syria one of the highest grades for economic reform and presented Syria as an exemplary case. Uh, And in the report, they mentioned the timing of liberalization was excellent. And they said timing of liberalization could not have been better. And then they were referring to toxic debt crisis affected the Wall Street, and saying that when all these things were happening in the West, Syria was putting into practice a very open neoliberal policy. This was very brave, and this will bring extremely good results for Syria. So it is still in their website. I checked all this information. They haven't pulled it back. So, I mean, maybe all these are to some extent predictable. But what I tried to do in my articles and what I will still be doing in my book, I will try to put all these into a global shift perspective. Apart from my students, probably you are not completely aware what I am talking about. What does global shift perspective mean? It is somewhat related to the historical analysis of the economies, countries, positioning in the world. But there is always my first explanation in order to explain your global shift perspective is there is always one world system. So nothing economically remains outside of the system. So whatever happens in this world, wherever in this world, was in this one single world system. But within this world system, all the economies, countries, multinationals, they all occupy different positions. And these positions determine the level of power, the level of influence they exercise in the world economy. So in simple terms, at the very center, the core economy is the most powerful, the strongest economies, or one major economy or empire, always is at the in this core level, and most of the events, most of the structures, most of the policies being affected by this core. And around this core, there are other economic powers. They are, I call this semi-core. And around this, there is semi-periphery, and at the very outside, it is periphery. Most of the weakest, poorest economies are located here, and the richest ones are located here, and all the others are located accordingly. This is a historical structure. But of course, this structure never remains the same. But of course, once a group of countries, economies, became the core economies, they stay in that position for a reasonably long period of time. But after a while, as a result of competition from the others, they couldn't remain in that position, and they decline, and some others come and move this position. And this position also called hegemonic position. So they are the hegemonic powers. They determine, they decide almost everything important in the world, sometimes in coordination with others, or sometimes not. So the change in this hegemonic position I call global shift. And global shift happened several times in the world history. It doesn't happen too often, but it happens like once a century or most of the times once in two or three centuries. Once in a while it was China and India, the core economies, trading everyone, producing everyone, and determining all the conditions of trade and production in the world. And around 18th century, European colonial powers, they replaced China and India. China and India declined in economic strength, in political strength, and first Dutch Empire played this role, and then British Empire was the hegemonic power. And around the turn of the century, 19th to 20th century, the United States started to challenge the British Empire, and probably from around the Second World War onwards, officially United States became the major core power. So now, currently, what I'm saying is, according to this picture, another global shift is happening and what was happening the last 10, 15, 20 years and what recently emerged as the global financial crisis and economic downturn. These were all the consequences of this global shift. Or in a way, I use another term, global fault lines, referring to almost earthquake kind of movements among the fault lines. And when the fault lines come and push each other, and there were sudden changes like earthquakes. And 2007-08 crisis was something like that. So in this global shift picture, if I put all what I told before about North Africa and Middle East, if I put them in that context, what does it mean? This global shift picture has a very important demographic dimension. So demography plays a very important role because when used effectively, a country's population, large population, young population is probably the most significant ingredient for any kind of economic progress, more than anything else, more than any other resource, even more important than oil. And this is exactly what is happening now. As I said, from late 1970s onwards, a large population increase happened in the world. And especially those countries which can be considered in the global south, the previously underdeveloped countries, another term, developing countries, they experience this population increase more than the rest of